आई एम सुमन खन्ना अग्रवाल, प्रोफेसर ऑफ फिलोसफी इन दिल्ली यूनिवर्सिटी. आई टीचिंग टिल डिसम्बर 2013. गांधीयन स्कॉलर विद अ PhD ऑन गांधी. I've written books on Gandhi and also lecture abroad, taught courses in American, Canadian universities, in Japan, in Brazil, also in Jerusalem. It's a privilege to be invited to this conference as a speaker and as an awardee. I would like to begin by congratulating the organizers. It's a very mammoth task to organize a conference of such magnitude with so many speakers from so many different countries, so many sessions, and of course a 6-day conference. It must have entailed a lot of work, and I congratulate all of you for putting up such a big show. The nicest part of this conference is the networking. It's a privilege to meet so many women from different countries, different backgrounds, different walks of life. And it's important that we should have a conference on women. As a Gandhian scholar, I would like to quote Gandhi, where he says, "Judge a country by the place it gives to its women." So it's very important that it's an all-women conference, and a platform is being given to people to air their views, to come out into the public domain, and maybe also make policy in due course of time. I'll be speaking on 2 sessions on the anatomy of conflict from a Gandhian perspective. Since I have also applied Gandhi concretely, because Gandhi says that poverty is the worst form of violence. So 11 years ago, I started a Gandhian NGO, the community service wing of a Gandhian NGO. It's called Shanti Sahyog, and we work in 17 slums in South Delhi, in Kalkaji Goenpuri area, in the field of education, health, and women empowerment, also vocational training. It's going quite well. We also have a very big program for women, which is called Awaaz Uthao in Hindi, which translates into Raise Your Voice. This is against sexual harassment or domestic violence, against harassment in public places. It's a lot, and the person, the coordinator of this Awaaz Uthao or Raise Your Voice program, is a woman from the slum who also has been very empowered by our Gandhian NGO Shanti Sahyog to come out from into the public domain. She now works as a coordinator. She ties up with the police, the civil people, the judges, and the women in the slums. A lot of networking is done there too. I would like to take this opportunity to talk a little bit about Gandhi. It's how Gandhi says that conflict is not the problem. The problem, real problem in the world today, is conflict resolution. That is how you handle conflict, how you deal with conflict. And because there will always be conflict. Conflict is actually a difference of opinion. And it can be a difference of opinion at any level, from the personal to the professional, to the regional, to the national, and the international. So a conflict of interest, and resulting from that difference of opinion, or a clash of interest. So the problem is how to resolve it. And there are 2 ways. Conflict, according to Gandhi, can be constructive and positive if you use non-violence to resolve it. And that is Gandhi's legacy to us, his concept of, and even practice of, more important, his practice of non-violent conflict resolution. Based on that, we have started another unit of Shanti Sahyog. It is called Shanti Sahyog Center for Peace and Conflict Resolution. The main focus is on promoting Gandhi's legacy of non-violent conflict resolution. I would like to share with you an international initiative which we have started, the main goal is to have a world beyond war. In other words, nation states should not go to war. So it's a very focused aim. It's based on Gandhi's view that non-violence is a science. So as a science, it is a systematic body of knowledge. It's not just an emotion or a feeling or a sentiment, but it is a science. That means a systematic body of knowledge with its own laws and principles. Secondly, like any other science, it must be studied. And like any other science, if you study it properly, only then can you apply it properly. Here I'd like to quote Gandhi, where he says, non-violence can never fail. What fails is our imperfect practice of it. And I'd like to point out here, give you some facts and figures. Though everybody wants non-violence or a non-violent world order, we want non-violence in our societies, but the global military expenditure, that in other words, the world is spending $2 million plus every minute teaching how to use violence to resolve conflict. And we are not even spending $1 a minute teaching how to use non-violence to resolve conflict. So if we want to restore the balance, I share this initiative with you. We urge, or rather demand, from every country around the world. There are three demands actually. In a democracy, you're allowed to demand. So we call it a demand. The first demand is that without abandoning the present military defense, a parallel non-violent defense be instituted in every country of the world. What does this mean? Let me explain. You have a defense country in every, you have a defense ministry in every country. Right now it's only military defense. Well, we keep that, but every country also starts a ministry for peace or a non-violence ministry. And at the grassroots level, like every country has a military training academy or a college, like you have West Point in the States, you have NDA and IMA in Delhi, every country has one. So every country also starts a non-violence training academy. And there's a blueprint for what will be taught there. Very briefly, there are 198 non-violent tactics that will be taught. Number two, the history of non-violence. Number three, non-violent communication. Number four, the philosophy of non-violence, why non-violence, and of course, non-violence R&D. So this is in a nutshell, the blueprint. The second demand, all we need is the necessary political will to put it into practice. The second demand from every country around the world is the legal democratic option to be trained in non-violent defense. Let me take an example from India. A lot of Indians join the forces to defend their country. They don't want to learn how to kill, but they want a job. It's for their bread and butter. So there should be an option. If you can either learn how to kill, you learn how to kill, you learn how to go to war. It's not natural to know how to use a gun. You learn how to use a gun or a machine gun. In the similar way, you also learn how not to go to war, how to use non-violent tactics. So there should be the legal democratic option to train when you go to defend your country. You can either join military defense or non-violent defense. The third is the legal democratic option for taxpayers to give their tax. The option should be from either military defense or non-violent defense. So there should be an option for giving the tax for non-violent defense. So on our income tax return papers, there should be two boxes, and you could just tick mark military defense, non-violent defense. Let's say half the taxpayers all over the world sign up for non-violent defense. What would happen? This $2 million plus every minute, it would become $1 million plus every minute for military defense, and $1 million plus every minute would be released for non-violent defense. So when you do something new, you always need funds. So you would have all your funding to start a non-violence academy, to enroll people for staff, for books, for R&D, everything. So that is how, and then of course, 50 years, 100 years is nothing in terms of nation or world history. Let's say if today we start learning how to use non-violent tactics, maybe in 50 years or in 100 years, we would have the tools and the skills of non-violent conflict resolution. And so future generations would not need to go to war. Right now, we don't have the tools and the skills. We only have the tools and the skills of how to kill the other nation, how to kill people. And of course, nuclear weapons is the ultimate weapon, which can destroy and all of humankind in a few hours, and you'd have nuclear winter after that. So my request to all of you is that think about choosing non-violent defense so that we can move on in world history. And I'd like to say that I'm very optimistic, like Gandhi is, about human nature. And if you look at world history, it's also something very positive. For instance, slavery is a thing of the past. You have the UN Declaration of Equality and human rights, and so nobody today, maybe the consciousness has gone that nobody is really inferior to another. So the concept of equality is very much there. Secondly, let's look at gender equality. And I'm, of course, there's a lot needs to be done at the practical level, but no man can get up in a hall or in a public place and tell a woman, look, I'm superior to you because I'm a man. You know, the consciousness has gone. It's very much, gender equality is there to stay. So in the same way, let us move beyond killing. Why kill each other? So it's a very focused campaign, international campaign, that nations should not go to war. So what we are working for is the political legitimization of non-violent conflict resolution. Today, we have only politically legitimized violence as a means of conflict resolution, and we spend $2 million a minute on this, and therefore we have standing army, navy, air force, weapons, nuclear weapons. So I invite all of you to think about this if you want to pay a true tribute to Gandhi. Let's all choose non-violent defense, and in doing so, make history the way Gandhi did. Thank you.